Not everything metal was created equal.
What an ugly thing to say.
The Metal Sucks Podcast. Shiggity Chuck and Godless attempt to bring order to chaos or just make stupid jokes about dumb people.
Stupid. A person below normal intelligence.
This is the Metal Sucks Podcast.
Greetings and salutations, my fine metal friends. Welcome to another edition of the Metal Sucks Podcast. How you doing? I'm Chuck.
I'm Godless.
And this is your weekly examination of all things metal, the Metal Sucks Podcast. We've got a special edition for you this week, the Housecore Horror Film Festival edition. It happened this weekend, and we wanted to crank it out and bring it like the day after, because we got some, you know, breaking news here, dude. We got to talk to the Decapitated guys like right after they had their car wreck. Holy crap. That was vicious. So we're going to talk to lead singer from Decapitated. We're going to talk to Vulvatron in this episode. We're also going to get a little gay on Voivod. That's just a little bit of what's coming up in this episode. And make sure that you are subscribed to us on iTunes. Very easy. Just search Metal Sucks Podcast on iTunes, and you can become a subscriber. Leave 5 stars and tell us that we suck. We do appreciate that. Also, you can follow us on the Twitter box. I'm at Bearded Ape.
I'm at Godless Speaks.
And, we can talk about all things metal. And this week, I mean, that's all we were talking about all weekend long, was just the craziness that was happening at this festival. Was so insane, dude.
I feel bad because, you know, when there's so many great metal bands that were there, I wish that I like understood horror film as well as I understood metal bands, because then I'd like be able to go, oh my god, and they had this movie and that movie and that movie, you know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
I don't know that world that well.
Well, I mean, you know? I understand horror films, but at the same time, I'm so ingrained in the metal part of it that I sort of slip when it comes to the movies.
Yeah,
I mean, we watched the documentary, the Rigor Mortis documentary, the preview of it, really. Yep. And that was pretty much the only thing. I watched some of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 40th edition that they played, but it was so packed that it was just, it was crazy, oh, man. So
you went to that last night?
Yeah. After the show, after the Gwar show. So it was like, yeah, all right, I want to check this out. And it was just, it was insane.
That's one of the greatest movies.
The line
ever.
Was all the way out, all the way out and past. It's like, man, dude. But you know, that kind of stuff. So I mean, the shorts and the other films, like some of that stuff is I don't want to say it's lost on me, because I like watching it. I think it's fun.
We checked out that short right before the Rigor Mortis doc, and that was really cool.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, that stuff is really cool, but it just seems like I wish I had more time. And I guess that's a good thing to have for a festival, when there's just too much shit going on for you to catch all of it. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's something for everybody, no matter what.
Yeah, I mean, there was the Lamb of God doc was showing at the same time Voivod were on stage.
Yeah, right.
And that was like, I mean, like, more than anything, I wanted to see Voivod. And then, but like, third on my list was seeing that movie. Yeah. You know, so it's like, I love it when you go to a festival and like you can't see all that you want to see.
Yeah.
Every time I hear somebody go, oh man, it sucks the way they program it, because they had this awesome over here and that awesome over there, that means there's too much awesome.
It was the guy that we talked about on the 70,000
tons of metal.
That's
right.
This is too much. There's too much for me to see.
Too much awesome.
There is too much awesome for me to see on this boat. This is not, we cannot do this. And that's sort of what it was all weekend. And just some of the craziness, man. I mean, the artists that were there, for some of the vendors and all that good stuff. We saw some bands with really good merch.
Still a lot of, yeah, there's still just not enough non-black t-shirts,
but it was funny how we walk around and judge the merch tip. Well, okay, you got don't take credit cards.
What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna start taking pictures, and I'll ask the Metal Sucks guys if I can give it, like, here's a bad merch table, here's a really bad merch table,
like a comparison, like
I'll like Photoshop in the circles of, you know, why do you have this here, and your price is written in a marker. You know, and just really get nitty gritty about people's merch tables.
That's actually not a bad idea. Yeah. So you could like totally judge it, and we can put it on a sliding scale of like 1 to 10 of what they have or what they don't have. I mean, because Gwar won hands down, they win everything, because they get the bobbleheads, they get the flasks, they've got the everything, they get the batteries for your e-cigs over there that are wrapped with fucking Gwar on it. So I mean, they had everything on there. That merch table, awesome. Then you look over at Neurosis.
Well, hold on a second, because before we moved to Neurosis, because I wanted to bring that up too, but like, we met that guy who had taken pictures of some of the stuff that he bought at the Macabre merch table.
Dude, yeah, yeah, I know.
They had like a Jeff Boyardee, Jeff Dahmer, Human Stew. Like,
yeah, that was awesome.
That's all it is they just threw paper
around a ravioli can.
And it's awesome.
Yeah.
$10. Done.
That and the McDonald's shirt or the macabre shirt.
Yeah.
With the Ronald and the guns.
Yeah. Brilliant.
Good stuff. Good stuff. And that kind of variety goes a long way. And I mean, and then, like I said, you look at Neurosis and it's all black and gray. But like for a Neurosis fan,
that's worse.
Yeah, I was totally down with it because they had vinyl and they had black and white T-shirts.
I saw more than one person standing around, completely encumbered for Gwar with an LP under a Neurosis LP underneath their arm and a Neurosis T-shirt in their other hand.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, it works for those fans that are out there, and it's fun to see what people bring to stuff like this, because whether it's artists or even the actors and stuff from the movies, you know, all the guys from the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 40th anniversary. I mean, you got to see what they brought and all the stuff that, because there are people that had props from the movies and had, I mean, there's some really amazing stuff to check out.
Yeah, now I'm a fan of the original movie, but I'm not like an uber fan of any movie really. But
you don't own a Leatherface mask sitting in the corner.
But
you
know? But like the panel where they got everybody who's you know, all the surviving cast members together in one room. I mean, just as a fan, not a like uber fan, but pretty cool as an uber fan. I mean, I thought I saw more than one guy standing there with his pants around his ankles, just jerking while that panel's going on, you know? And it's interesting, 'cause like that sort of discussion is very, very different from like the type of discussion that I'm like a fan of, you know. I prefer like much more like in depth.
Oh yeah.
One or two people, but you know, people had the opportunity to ask their burning question about, you know, that original movie to the people who were there. And
well, you've never been to a Comic-Con before, have you?
No.
Okay, so see, if you go to a Comic-Con, like panels at Comic-Cons are that's exactly kind of how they run a lot of time. And they'll be a little more specific where you take the half hour and moderator is talking to the entire cast of Star Trek or whatever.
Right.
And so nobody really gets to answer anything crazy, or they ask about this one story that they heard on blah blah blah, it's on Wikipedia or whatever, and they got to tell the story of that. But then the fans ask the questions, and some of them, every once in a while, you'll get a good, really good one. And you know, you've seen videos of the ones where one of my favorites was when a girl asked Picard about like gay rights or something, and that was like his response was like brilliant, you know. But those are rare, really, really, really rare. Most of the time, it's like, so did you have fun working on the set of blah blah blah? And that's what you get. But I mean, that's sort of what you got to expect out of those things, you know. And that's, I could see where it would be a little cumbersome, but getting all those people in the same room together, more than anything, is just having them in the same place. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Because and the thing that you notice, and we'll talk about it a little later in the show, is about, you know, just hobnobbing with people like that, because they're all wandering around.
Yep.
You're going, I'm that's fucking Bill Johnson right there, dude. That's Leatherface, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, dude. What's up, bro? How you doing? You know, and then get to take a picture and done.
Yeah.
You know, wait, what's Randy Blythe doing walking around here everywhere?
Yeah, he's having conversations with absolutely everybody there.
Everyone, I know.
Except for us.
Well, I had a little conversation. I talked to him.
All right, yeah. He didn't talk to me.
Well, you know, it's because of what you were wearing. You didn't have your button up on.
I didn't have my button up yesterday.
Yeah, if you were wearing a button up, you might have been like, okay, maybe I'll talk to this guy.
I was the only person at Housecore yesterday who was bummed out because he couldn't get to the dry cleaners before getting to the festival.
I had mentioned that to somebody because we met a few we met some fans while we were out there of the podcast, which I can't believe it actually exists. Matt and Malcolm was another guy that we met.
Very cool to meet him from Chicago.
So we met a few fans that were
Jay out
there.
From here in town, and yeah, a bunch of people. It's awesome.
And we were talking about your attire typically when you come out to a metal show, and how you are the ultimate troll when it comes to that, because that's the beautiful thing. It's the most metal thing to do is to wear a freaking suit and tie or a button up shirt to a metal show, because everybody's like, who the fuck's that guy?
Yeah.
What's that all about? I don't know.
I'm living that book from the 60s, Black Like Me. You know, that's what I'm doing, you know? I'm just experiencing the prejudice.
Right. Yeah, and you do get some.
Yeah, I soak it in.
What I love is when we do interviews and they're like, why do you wear such clothes? I don't understand why you wear such clothes.
Yeah, I've only been almost assaulted one time.
Okay, wait, which one was that?
Well, you weren't there. That was like some dude in the hallway. highway at 70,000 tons.
Oh.
At 3:30 in the morning or something.
Yeah, you told me about that.
Yeah, that's the only time.
Yeah, but he was really hammered, and he doesn't even remember that.
Hey, speaking of 70,000 tons, we've got a news flash.
Yeah, a little drop there.
Yeah, we everybody's looking for the news, and we finally got a little news.
Possibly.
That's later on, yeah.
So we're going to talk to Vulvatron here a little bit. We're going to talk to Away from Voivod, and also we got to kick this off with a little bit of an interview from Rasta, from lead singer from Decapitated, fresh off of another fucking accident. Oh my God, I can't believe that it actually happened. They were on their way to New Orleans and wiped out their bus.
Yeah, if you haven't seen the pictures, I'm sure Metal Sucks will have them if they don't already. It's freaking scary.
So, welcome, Decapitated, to the MetalSucks Podcast.
Chuck, I'm Godless from the MetalSucks Podcast. We're talking to Rasta from Decapitated on the day after one of the most exciting days you have ever had.
Yeah, we can say hello, everybody. Yeah, we can say it was one of the most exciting days, but I think it was one of the worst. But yeah, I'm glad to be here, bro.
What happened? Who was driving?
It wasn't our fault, you know. It was like car crash, you know, couple cars, you know, just hit each other, and we were in this row, so we got hit too. Our car, like van, was totally destroyed, and we are lucky to be here, bro. It was like good, you know, like good time for us that we are here. It's cool. I'm very happy to be here.
Now, that was like on the road to New Orleans, right?
Yeah, it was like 10 minutes before we just reached the club, you know. It was like 2.5 miles, you know, just before the New Orleans, so House of Blues. So
did you guys play last night?
Yeah, of course we did it.
Holy like crap,
we,
dude.
We made it, of course. Yeah, we've been quite late, you know, like 30 minutes before the show, so we just do, you know, like fast line check, and it was a great show, to be honest. You know, we appreciate that, you know, that we've been there on stage, not in a different place. Yeah.
So you're on the highway and a crash happened in front of you?
Yeah, somebody hit other cars, you know. I don't know, because I was sitting in a back seat, you know. It was kind of liner, so I was sitting in a back seat, you know, and suddenly something happened. So I just remember, you know, like kind of shock, but it was lucky for us.
So it was just, you know, you're just like all of a sudden you're thrown from where you're at, or is there a noise, or is it slow down, or what happened?
I just noticed that we just hit something, you know, and I fell down from my seat, you know. I started to move forward to the, you know, like front of the car, like all the guys, some of them just hit head, and it was kind of scary, bro. My bass player broke his nose, you know. He was like bleeding as fuck, you know. I was like, maybe he has a shock, you know, I don't know. Like brain, you know, shock, I don't know. Yeah. But it was cool, all in all, like, and if everything ended, like, in a good way.
You say fell down, and I look at the picture of the van, it doesn't look like anything fell.
Right. It was crashed, you know. I'm used to it, because a couple years ago, like 3 years ago, we had, like, a landing without the wheels. Maybe you heard about it. So,
no,
this van is like a little bit professional in accidents. You know what I mean? We try to make jokes on it, you know.
You guys are the Def Leppard of death metal.
Maybe. I wouldn't say it, but I don't want to. Man, I didn't want it, never. So
yeah.
I hope it will be like last time.
So who was driving?
Our driver, man. He's a cool guy. He's really careful. Like, since 20 years, he's a driver, professional driver. He never even had, like, even, you know, like, small accident. So he was surprised too, man, because for him it was like suddenly happened, the same as for us, you know. It wasn't his fault, so good we are here.
Shaking up?
No, it's all cool. After this play, I'm used to it.
Yeah.
So the two people went to the hospital?
Yeah, our merch guy, Aaron, and my bass player. Okay. But all in all, it was like, you know, just research what could happen, but all in all, it's good.
Yeah, when they see blood, they got to take you to the hospital, kind of thing.
Yeah, you know, we decided to do it because we've got like 1 week after, you know, of the tour. We just started like 5 weeks tour with Gwar, so we want to do it when I finish, man. Yeah, right. It's a great tour, you know, like good people, good atmosphere. And of course, Gwar is an amazing band, you know, they treat us like great.
Well, and you're on, you know, on tour for the new record and everything, too. You want to make sure you're jamming that out at the same
time.
Yeah,
actually, right? This is like first tour, first shows we ever made, you know, after Blood Mantra release. So you know, I'm really glad to be here, you know. It's a good stuff to play, you know. We recorded this new music, like this new stuff, to have something like different on our shows, you know, to have like more groovy songs, and it works.
I like it. It's a lot different than what you guys have done in the past, and I mean, you can still hear the Decapitated feel, but I mean, you guys bring a lot of different
you have to notice that this band had a lot of lineup changes. Oh, yeah. You know, because of some fatal, you know, accidents that happened in the past, yeah, of course. And also, you know, when Vogue got back with the band, like 2009, I'm the only one member who stayed with him, you know what I mean? Because it's hard to start something like again, you know, you have to choose the people, and sometimes it doesn't work, you know, you've got a perfect musician and you cannot communicate each other. You know, they're cool guys, you know, as a friends, they're cool guys, but you couldn't find like common language, you know, musically. So we decided to change the people, you know, and now it's working, you know. I feel really great with the new lineup, the cool guys, you know, we're starting to getting, you know, like having like groove each other, playing on stage. We always have fun, we hang out with each other a lot, you know, so it's cool.
So it's just kind of a natural.
Yeah, but you have to remember that Vogue was always composer of this band. And you know, I think the spirit of Decapitated, even if you look at the past, every album is different. Like Organic Hallucinosis is different than Negation. Winds of Creation is totally different than Calling Vice Fall and Nihility. You know, every album is different. I think it's good. I like it. You know, I never been a like extreme huge fan of extreme music like metal. But of course, I love bands like Cannibal Corpse, Obituary. They're my bands from childhood. I love Pantera, you know. But I was listening to like metal in general, you know. Like, I like guitar sound. I like, you know, double bass drum. I love it, yeah. But you know, when I heard Decapitated, Searching for the Singer, I checked them out, you know, like, because I haven't heard a lot of them about, you know, like before. And I check it and I love it, man. I feel the groove of this guy, you know. Vogue is a fucking great, you know, guitar player, and I feel it, you know.
And now you get to stretch your legs a little bit more and try different things.
Yeah, of course. And you know, and what I love the most, he's trying to take something from the members he has in the band, you know. He knows my abilities, my skills, and he tries to use it, you know. He is not like composing the music and okay, you sing like this, listening to this. He's trying to, you know, like communicate with you, and this is great. This is great.
Well, and you're not trying to imitate the past either.
Yeah. No. I never try to. Of course, yeah. Like I love Kovan. He was like one of the greatest singer in this kind of music. Seriously, his sound is like unique, original. And of course, Sauron is the most brutal singer I ever heard from Poland. So. That, all my friends, you know, like, of course, Kovan is in a bad condition now, but we are visiting him, you know, with Sauron and with all the band members. And actually, you know, we're trying to support him. But, you know, this is like kind of family. You know, we know each other because we live in the same city, so we're trying to contact each other, and it's cool.
So how do the fans take this, take the change that you guys are going through a little bit? Because, I mean, I've been a fan of the band for a long time.
Yeah.
I kind of see it from a music critic's eyes, and that's always weird.
You mean how but, us to begin well, again, you know,
well,
to start it again, yeah?
To begin again, because I know that some people are like, oh, Decapitated should stop now that all this tragedy has happened and all this, and then others are like, no, you should keep going. Like, but then
you
like,
know,
the sound changes.
I heard many interviews, you know, when Vogue was talking about it. I can say from my side, you know, like, I feel the spirit of Decapitated is still continuing. You know, Vogue has a brother, Vitek, who died. He was like, also one of the main composers in this band. He created a lot of stuff with Vogue, and it's kind of, you know, like tribute to the guys that passed away, and you know, like, we're trying to continue it, like, you know, like remember about Vitek. And of course I respect everything that happened. I'm not feeling like, you know, like that I'm, you know, cutting the tickets after, you know, somebody's, you know, achievements. I'm doing something in my way, you know. I'm doing something what I feel with the guys, you know. But we wanted to go back with the same, you know, name, under the same name, because this is still Decapitated, yeah?
That's a great name.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, I love it, yeah.
You can actually score that name in metal. I mean, you can't get rid of that.
Yeah, totally.
There's no way.
It's a good name, yeah. I like it. Usual, you know, on the airport, like, some guy, you know, from the security, of course, you know, like control, passport control, they ask us, okay, what is the name of your band? Decapitated. Oh, I guess you're not playing jazz, man. So it's funny, yeah. Yesterday was the same, like policeman after the accident came to me, okay, what is the name of your band? Decapitated. And he does like city face, you know, like started to smile.
Well, now that you're kind of pulling this new material out, I mean, it's still pretty fresh. When the album's been out for,
yeah,
what, a month
it was
now?
Like 25th in Europe, like, so 29 in US,
so, you know,
last month, yeah.
Month,
yeah, it's month after, yeah.
Fans, good reception so far and all that?
From what I saw, they love it, you know? Yeah. Because it has something like from the new Decapitated, also like common, you know, like things from...
Like you're saying, the more for the groove,
yeah,
sort of thing that you,
yeah,
guys are,
like,
doing.
From the older albums. I like it, I like this material, you know, it sounds great on live. I love to play it, you know, it's groovy. I have time, you know, to mosh a little bit. I have time, you know, to sing a little bit different in this new material. I love to do it, man. It's cool.
I hate to go back to this van accident, right? But
yeah.
But dude, we just got done talking to Voivod. They're talking about how they had a van accident. It took a year off. We talked to Mark Osequenda of Death Angel.
He killed the band.
You guys are like, we were a few minutes late for sound check.
This is what I said to you. Like, we laugh about it. You know, like, we are professional accident band, man.
They survived another crash. Unreal. Decapitated on the Metal Sucks podcast, man. Those guys. Crash.
Yeah.
Bus crashes. Car crash. I mean, they just need to wrap themselves in bubble wrap, dude.
You know, if I were a documentarian, I'd like...
Not be in there.
I would not be anywhere near them yet because who knows what it's gonna really catch up
or
again.
Just,
you know,
follow along with a dash cam or something, man. Because damn, dude. Yeah.
You know, I gotta ask you a question though. I said to him, I think you're the Def Leppard of death metal, and the look on his face, like,
I don't think he got the reference.
I don't think he knew who Def Leppard was.
Well, you got to remember that's kind of an old reference. You know.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Yeah, it's sort of an old reference. I mean. You know, not the what has seven arms and sucks, but it's okay though. Yeah. Don't worry about it.
All right, cool.
I wouldn't expect technical death metal guys to be that familiar with the history of Def Leppard, even though I am. I knew where you were coming from.
I thought everybody was.
Well, maybe, but it's okay. Now, our next interview, we had the pleasure of interviewing one of the newest members of Gwar. Vulvatron.
But we also had the pleasure last night the interview of seeing the new Gwar show.
So that was the thing, is that we did all of our interviews kind of trying to do them all in one swath so that they were all during the day. So it was before we got a chance to see Gwar and see the new performance and what it's all about. So I would say as far as... I wish we would have seen it beforehand because I would have had so many more questions, right?
Yes.
But seriously, I mean, you know, it's a fun interview, but the performance, dude, oh my God, it was so spot on. And it was so perfect. I mean,
10 out of 10.
I'm a Gwar fan. I've been a Gwar fan for 20 years, right? I've seen them.
You're the dude who said they should have broken up as soon as Odorous had kicked it.
I felt like they couldn't. I felt like they couldn't move on. Yeah. And that was my initial reaction to the death of Dave Brocky, because I felt in my heart of hearts that it was the wrong thing to do would be to move on, because he was so integral and so important and it was such a big deal that they couldn't do it. And I have been proven completely and utterly wrong.
I got to say, this band dragged a oversized needle across the stage, and it was still the most tasteful tribute to Dave Brocky you could possibly imagine. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I know, dude. I mean, it was perfect. It really was. It was the perfect way to send I almost got no words for it, because I mean I was crying. Yeah. I cried last night at the Gwar show.
Well, you've seen them like dozens and dozens of times. I think I'd seen them like three times before last night, right? And so like my experience with Gwar is sort of like, there's a lot of blood, you know, and it's mayhem.
No, so for me, it's like I've seen this show so many times that the specifics of it, you know, I remember when Sleazy P was in there. I remember when Slemenster Hyman was in there for the first, you know, like back in the day, you know what I mean? So I remember all these characters that used to come in, and knowing what they were going to try to do with it, I was like, okay, well, it sounds like they're going back to sort of the same sort of cavalcade where they're pulling people out and it's going to be these different characters. But I didn't really think that I don't know why I didn't have it in my head that they would really come up with a unified story on how this whole thing would go. And they did it fucking perfect. It was perfect.
And Vulvatron will talk about a lot of that in our interview. But I mean, you're absolutely right. I think that like Blothar, first of all, performance wise.
Yeah.
100%.
Guy's amazing.
Totally great.
Yeah. I mean, he nailed the vocals, like the Brocky vocals. I mean, he just nailed it down, dude. Sounded great.
And he even has me excited to hear new original music with his voice on.
Really?
You know what I mean?
I agree.
And that's saying a whole hell of a lot.
And then adding the female vocals on top of it with Vulvatron even enhanced it even further, gave it another sort of shocking little piece to it.
Didn't I predict last year, like as more like 2014 predictions, was that there was going to be a metal island in the stream?
Oh yeah, well,
and
there you go.
Maybe it's 2015 and Gwar is gonna do it. All you know right. What I mean?
Yeah.
But that's what they I mean, it was And they played The Road Behind, and it was so great.
Yeah, The Road Behind, that's where everybody said they cried, but The Road Behind was great, but that's not what got me. It was the end is what got me, man.
Yes.
But I mean, when they first started, they had the hologram of Odorous going into the wormhole and singing, the opening song, and it was like, oh boy, this is going to be rough, you know, and it just started the story. Like it started the whole night like that, and it was a tight show. Like the script that they were going on was really tight, and all the characters got their piece, so you had everything in there. I mean,
Blothar, former Beefcake the Mighty, right?
Yeah,
so that guy has been a college professor for years for English, I think. So this guy, I think, knows storytelling better than he ever has, and probably better than Dave Brocky did.
Yeah.
And that skill, I think, is going to be critical for them going into the future. And it made last night just one of the... This is what makes a difference between a great metal show and so many other performances, right? Is that no matter how many Gwar concerts you see, no matter how many metal shows I go to, I'm going to remember last night.
Oh, totally. I mean, there's no way you can't, because it was just funny, because I was shocked at first when, okay, so what they did, the last song that they did, and I'm going to, the spoiler.
Oh, I meant to look up what the name of the band is that came up with that. Do you remember whose song that is?
Came up with what?
The punk rock song they covered.
Oh.
It's one of my all-time favorites. But it doesn't matter. We'll look it up tweet it or something.
No, hang on.
But okay, so they start with a cover of one of the all-time great bands that I couldn't believe they were insulting before they started performing it. But they did a really awesome cover.
Really? You can't believe they were insulting
everybody. The Pet Shop Boys, really? Everybody should revere the Pet Shop Boys. They played West End Girls, one of the all-time greats, right? Dude, somebody was yelling at me just the other day because I had my music cranking somewhere, and it was like death metal, 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 Pet Shop Boys, death metal. I mean, because they're freaking great.
It was Jim Carroll.
Okay, Jim Carroll. All right,
because he was a writer. And it was the whole Basketball Diaries and all that stuff. Yeah, there.
Gotcha. Oh, these are friends that have died, and they did.
What? They did People Who Died, and because it went from West End Girls to West End Boys, and they broke into People Who Died in the middle of it, right? And it was like, and I, as soon as they started that song, the first thing that ran through my mind was like, I wonder if they're going to change the lyrics.
Uh-huh.
And that's exactly what they did.
It was great.
It was fucking perfect.
It gave context. You know what it did? It provided context for just how important to metal not only Dave Brocky has been, but Gwar in general has been.
Because they're tied to so many different people. Yes. Because they, in the lyrics, like I posted a video of I think a performance from a week ago, and they included Dimebag. They included Corey. I mean, obviously Corey Smoot. They included Dave Brocky in there. Of course, he was the last one that they put in there. But I want to say they put Joey Lacaze in there last night, and also Mike Scoscia as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, it was really like, it was really fucking perfect. It really was. And I mean, like, perfect for where they were, what they were doing that night, and it just it was so awesome.
Here it
so
is awesome. You know, this band from another universe comes to this stage, demolishes everybody, and then celebrates something very, very human at the same time, and it still worked.
And when you see them tear up on stage too, that was the other thing, was watching, you saw Beefcake, swipe some tears out of his eyes after it was done too. I mean, it was awesome, dude.
Yeah.
And a lot of big metal dudes that were like tearing up, man. It's like, oh man,
covered in blood and crying.
Exactly. That was awesome.
In fact, that sounds like the next Gwar album.
The new album.
Covered in blood and crying.
I love it. Well, let's get into our interview with Vulvatron. She's going to explain exactly where she comes from and how much crack she smokes.
You've got the gig of the universe.
The gig of the universe. Is that in Austin, Texas?
No, the gig in Gwar.
Oh, yes, Gwar, the greatest band of all time. It's okay.
So where did you come from? Are you from Scumdogia?
I am from Scumdogia, but it's not a different place that I come from the other Scumdogs so much as a different time. I am from the year 69,000, and I have traversed the fabric of the space-time continuum back to this pathetic planet in this ancient year.
I didn't think they allowed women around the men of Gwar.
Well, in 69,000, we don't necessarily still judge people by the nature of their bits. But they do seem to find my anatomy a bit shocking.
69,000 years, that's about the progress. That's about the speed of progress we would anticipate.
Mm-hmm.
Gender equality.
I don't know. We're still judging by bits. So.
Yeah. Yes.
So did you have to battle for this role?
Well, yes, I was fiercely engaged in a battle with the Futuro-Fascist forces when Odorous somehow dropped out of the wormhole and made a right mess of things. I have to talk to Larry, our wormhole technician, about this, because really he caused the ultimate and complete destruction of the universe in the future. So that is why I took it upon myself to traverse space-time back here to 2014 to assist Gwar in altering the trajectory of the current future path so that Gwar, scumdogs, and perhaps you humans too might still exist in my time.
Now, have they introduced you to the crack yet?
Oh, your crack, yes. Mm-hmm. Well, future crack in my time is really a masterpiece of chemical engineering. I have been consuming massive quantities of your earth crack to try to simulate its effects. With some success, however, I might add some terrible side effects. But I'm working with a chemical engineering staff right now to sort of emulate a more advanced formula.
So have you found anything else to take its place?
Oh, I'm quite fond of your ethyl alcohol and your male species.
I see that you are stained with...
Well, it's the blood of the innocent.
Yes. Now, is that pre-Gwar stains or as with now with Gwar stains?
Well, I mean, we had quite a good time last night after the show. I'm not quite sure what sort of fluids I'm stained with at the moment, but... I intend to go shower before the performance again tonight so that I might be covered in more fluids.
Now, the rumor was you were, you know, of course, trying to destroy the human race, but now infecting people with the Ebola, is that part of the plan now?
Well, of course, we introduced Ebola to try to kill humans, but unfortunately, it's not doing a very good job of spreading. We seem to have underestimated your intelligence and your hygiene standards in all but a few places.
Probably not.
Yes. We must make it airborne or perhaps psychoactive.
No, you mentioned Odorous went through a wormhole?
Yes.
Is any other member of Gwar in danger of the wormhole?
Well, it's a bit flaky right now. They're working on their time portal. We have them working in shifts, but they really quite can't seem to get the hang of it. Beefcake ordered a pizza through it the other day. It was quite good, actually.
Do you want anybody else to get sucked through the wormhole?
I would like to be sucked through the wormhole so that I don't have to be stuck in this archaic time for much longer, I hope.
Pustulus says that you run a tight ship. He says now everybody has to answer to you.
Oh, well, yes. I mean, I think they can sense a superior creature when they encounter one.
You're a Housecore, started by Phil Anselmo. In 69,000, in your part of the universe, are they aware of Phil Anselmo? Are they aware of Pantera? Or has he slipped into the sort of nether of time?
Well, yes, there are still terrible bar bands covering Pantera songs everywhere in the future. Regrettably, they are aware of Mr. Anselmo's works and try to emulate him futilely.
It's good to know that that still takes place in the future.
And how many Texas Chainsaw Massacre reboots have we had?
I think we are on 7,824. Number 821 was my favorite.
How many cameos by the guy who plays Grandpa?
Well, we have several circuits of horror conventions, and there's a whole warehouse full of the leather faces.
currently in the news here in the United States. In 2014, not only was there the slipping of voters through the wormhole, but there's also been what's been going on in Ferguson, Missouri with the police, and there seems to be a lot going of that going on around the states. What has been Gwar's influence on the police force in the United States in 2014?
Oh, well, they keep having to call the police on our shows. Our tour manager is very good at getting us out of trouble. I think that in the town in Missouri of which you speak, they seem to be very concerned about the color of their skin. I don't quite understand this notion, but your police force doesn't seem to be the brightest.
So, let's see, the future. You talk, you want to go back through the wormhole, but you're stuck here for now. So, where are you going to lead this band of misfits next?
Oh, well, I am stuck here until my mission with Gwar is complete, which is to alter the current course of action and to essentially save Scumdogia and, well, Earth as well, I guess.
Well, they've been working on this for, 20, 25 years now? I mean, so are you speeding up the timeline?
I gather that this is a long time in terms of Earth people lifetimes. I operate on a different inertial frame. But in my inertial frame, I would like to continue to earn lots of cash and have lots of after-show sex and drugs with Gwar for some time on this Earth planet. In my time, it's but a brief moment.
Well, we're super looking forward to the new incarnation of Gwar.
Well, you should be.
Yeah, so what... You always defy expectations, but the band always defies expectations, but is there anything that, you know, going into it that people should come in with, to be prepared to... Yeah, you're not going to get that, or...
Well, you should probably take out a life insurance policy before you come to see our show. But other than that, we have quite a few more cities that we intend to slaughter on this War Eternal tour. We are in, yes, Texas today, and then we are continuing to conquer cities through the U.S. and Canada to Baltimore. So you should probably... see what we have in store for you.
Absolutely. And obviously the one thing that, I mean, had to change was the sound of the vocals. So is there anything that you had to do to sort of try to either replicate or at least allude to the voice of Odorous?
Well, I have several PhDs in intergalactic musicology, and one of my specialties is in the primitive forms of rock and roll, of which Odorous Urungus was the greatest rock and roll singer of all time. My vocal sounds produced by my vocal cords do not emulate his sounds. In fact, the human ear can only hear a certain range of the wavelengths produced by my voice. However, so far, it seems that the humans are pleased by the sounds that emerge. I do also play the triangle, which is the most advanced instrument on Earth, but your people as well can only hear certain frequencies that it emits.
Have the new recordings been made, or are they yet to be made?
Oh, we have not made any recordings. We've been doing a fair bit of writing while we've been on the toilet, but hopefully future recordings of said masterpieces will yield us a lot more currency.
Was there anything that Odorous left behind?
Well, we keep finding bits of crack here and there, and all these girls keep coming to the show and saying that they knew him in one way or another and attempting to get backstage. Blother does not mind this, nor do I, if they're of a certain physique.
So should we expect new recordings in the new year?
Well, we have not put a timeline on it yet. However, it's not ruled out.
Any songwriting credits for Odorous, or is there no compositions that he left behind?
Oh, well, we have massive amounts of recordings of him reading gay porn novels. But I'm not sure if Gwar fans would enjoy that or not.
Do we know what Odorous was watching on television when he got slipped through the wormhole? Does anybody know?
Well, I believe what happened is you stupid humans created a time-space paradox in the year 2014 by throwing a Viking-era funeral for him, thus manifesting a wormhole, sucking him into the future and bringing that creature Blothar, who looks like a moose of some sort, here and interrupting my battle plans. So I don't know any more of it than that, other than that he's creating a right mess of things up there right now.
Well, we're super excited, right?
Yep. Can't wait to check out the performance and get slaughtered again.
Oh, excellent.
Once again by the mighty Gwar. So thank you, Vulvatron.
Yeah, thank you very much.
It is good to see that you humans still bow before us.
Still tearing up thinking about it, man. I still am. I can't help. But
I saw a tear in your eye when we were just talking.
That's what I'm saying, man. It's honestly that was touching. It really was, and I never thought I would say that about a Gwar show.
This is one of those tours that's kind of crucial.
And I got a feeling that if they keep this tour going into 2015 a little bit, that they're probably going to be doing the same storyline at least for a little while.
Yeah, this would be a tough one to. I wouldn't want to be the guy in Gwar who goes, okay, new story now. You know what I mean?
Well, I mean, they have to. I mean, they obviously have to. But at the same time, I think that from a Gwar fan perspective, like if you are a fan of Gwar, you need to see this tour.
Yes.
Because this is like the closure that you need. I mean, it really is, because I think that it actually closes the door on him going through the wormhole and sealing his fate kind of thing. So it's like it's great closure. It really was.
You know what? Gwar 2.0, it's hard to believe that like we're this many years into their career, like almost 30 years, yeah. Right? And now it's 2.0.
Yeah,
that's what it feels like. And it's going to be great. Mm-hmm. It really is going to be great, people.
I'm totally impressed. Totally impressed, and I'm so glad. So glad I watched it in whole set, man. It's so good.
And you know how cool of it. You know, Gwar played Housecore last year.
And that was the last time I saw Dave.
Yep, and now they come back again this year. Thank you to Housecore for bringing Gwar back. Because,
yeah, no doubt, man.
You know, I mean, I imagine that's one of those things where it's like, it's real easy to go, well, yeah, they played last year, let's not bring them back. Yeah. But thank you for doing something.
Yeah, it was perfect, man. Well, in Friday night of Housecore Horror Film Festival, I had to bow out because I have my radio show on Friday night.
Yes.
I did the Thursday night opening party, but, you know, that's made for a long-ass Friday. But you had the experience of a lifetime on Friday night with one of your favorites, eh?
Oh, yeah, they're totally. Voivod are, you know, I mentioned it in the interview, and I'll just say now, like, Voivod are this incredibly important band to metal history, and I also think they're one of the most underappreciated by the general community.
I would agree with that.
And it was interesting because, you know, there were a lot of people there to see Gwar last night.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people were there to see Voivod the night before because I was up front, you know what I mean? And I was not turning around to look. I was drilled into what it was going on. But I, you know, when they got up on stage, you know, there was a handful of us who were like, ear to ear smiles, but I didn't get the feeling that there were thousand people behind us, excited about it. But by the time they hit the second or third tune, that room was 100% theirs.
Yeah. Well, and I'll have to tell you this, that I left this interview pretty much intact because it was pretty cute. I was in the room for this interview, and you only hear me in this interview one time because going into it, he was still the Godless over here, was still doing research on his phone.
Yeah.
Even though he is like, total Uber fan of Voivod.
I just wanted to make sure I knew the order.
You were just freaking out.
It's a 30-year history.
I know. And there's a chance there's a minute there that it might have fell through. And you're, oh man, we gotta do So I pretty much left this interview almost entirely intact because you gotta hear it. He's totally freaking excited about it. I love it. It's pretty awesome.
I imagine the listener right now is either a huge Voivod fan or you're just like, Voivod, right? Yeah. Another, they think they're an also ran, but they're not an also ran by any stretch of the imagination. They were and still are just an awesome part of this scene.
Well, and two, I mean, I think the people don't also a lot of time don't associate with what the end result is, like where what they influenced and how they actually influenced it. So I mean, you if you don't have this noise metal craze that's going on right now with the bands like I Love like Nails and stuff like that, that there would not be that scene if these guys were not making that. If you're a crust punk, there would not be those things if Voivod was not around. I mean, he calls it trash metal in the interview, as far as what they were making then. But it's so much, it became what is this noise metal now, or what's kind of known as noise metal.
And he brought it up, and I thought it was a really great point, one of those connections that I hadn't directly made before, but now seems like, oh, it's so obvious. But like the science fiction themes that they were bringing up in Nothing Face and Dimension Hatros were directly lifted from by Fear Factory.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And nobody was selling bigger than Fear Factory for a while. There,
so know? let's get into our interview with the drummer from Voivod,
the only member of the band from beginning to end.
And he is like one of the most nice guys that we met during the festival. His name is, we call him Away, would be his name from the band Voivod on the Metal Sucks podcast.
30th anniversary, is that what this year is, or last year? Was
last
30th?
Year,
last year,
yeah.
No, all right, so. When Blackie leaves, do you call him up and go, this is a member of one of the greatest bands in the history of music. Are you sure you know what you're doing? Is that how that phone call goes?
It is involved. Yeah, that you know that conversation. But then you know when it's over. You know, and it's also a pattern that I was like a bit used to, because we had to go through it in the early 90s, and so I saw it coming. And it's tough to be a band and to have the same lineup forever. It's really tough. Yeah.
It's one of the things we keep on talking to bands that reunite, or bands who have been around forever, is they're like, look, I'm not the kid I was 25 years ago, so I'm able to let things slide that I never was able to before. And was that something on that just there was just something this time that just didn't grow?
It has a lot to do with business. We didn't agree on a lot of the business aspects and the way it was managed and all that, and he preferred to leave the band instead of having to deal with that. But when he came back in 2008, the whole machine was already set up with the new management and all that, and he had to deal with that. And I guess he didn't agree with everything, that how it was working and all that. And so it just sort of unraveled over a period of a couple of years, the last couple of years.
Oh, that's so upsetting. But, I mean, based on how Rocky performed last night, you guys got to be pretty happy with the
Oh, yeah. Career. Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, all kind of things over the course of 31 years. I was the only one there all the way through. And, I mean, people leave. Some people pass away, unfortunately, and the band splits and come and then gets back together and all that. So I think it's the main thing is the name Voivod is still really legit, and there's a way for us to just keep going and seeing the same friends over and over, and the people listening to Voivod are very loyal. They show up at the shows, they buy the albums, and so why not, you know?
And I think, like based on how well Planet...
Got Earth.
Yeah, Planet Earth got received. I mean, I don't know. It's got to be different. Like when you put out, you know, an early album, when you're early in your career, your expectations are always, you know, like, oh, well, let's see how... let's see if things can go in a particular direction with this, right? But when you, I would imagine when you're putting on an album at this point, it's sort of like album sales don't really matter anymore. It's just let's see if people like it. Were you surprised that people loved it as much as they did?
Yeah, actually, because especially with Blackie back in the band, people had to compare it to some legendary albums in the Voivod catalog. And we consciously tried to pick elements from the strongest material we had and sort of like give it a new twist with the new guitar player, Chewy, and all that. And but it's it's always a bit nerve-wracking to when you release something and you know it's going to be compared to killing technology and all that. And I just haven't seen one bad review. It's really amazing.
Yeah. So is it like, is that, when you produce an album like that, is this like I don't know, this is kind of a hard question to ask, but is it like, oh, let's see if we can try to get that same thing happening that we had before, or is it, no, we're going to go in this direction? You guys have always felt to me like one of the most progressive, not necessarily progressive metal, but like progressive in just the way you guys are thinking about your music at all times.
Well, we try to not overthink it too much, because then, like, if you start to sort of second guess the fact that you might not be up to date with what's going on in metal and all that, and then you start changing your style to accommodate the crowd, and I think it's always the wrong move. So the best thing is to do your own thing, and you know that if the Voivod signature is there, some people are gonna like it, and so we try not to overanalyze it too much and go with our guts. But like I was saying, we try to pay attention to the fact that people like the combo of psychedelia, metal, trash, punk, and all that, prog, and a bit of industrial, and you know, and so we try to keep that intact.
Is that something that you guys have learned how to do, or is that something that you've always strived for?
We always like try to do our own thing without like becoming grunge when it was time to, or techno, or we try to do our own thing, and sometimes it goes it has a lower profile, and sometimes it works, you know. And of course, like when we reformed in 2003 with Jason Newsted, it brought a lot of attention back to the band, and we've been like surfing ever since, you know. It's really cool.
Sorry. I feel so bad. I'm such a fan that it's like...
He's a mega fan, so when we talked about this, I was like, okay, go ahead. Just go. Just go for it. So, he's so cool. Excited about being here.
All right. Big question, right? So not only like one of my favorite metal albums, but really like one of my favorite albums of any genre was Angel Rat. You guys didn't play anything from Angel Rat last night.
No, we do play the Pra once in a while, and but since we had like 70 minutes yesterday, we had to get rid of a couple of tracks, including the Pra.
Angel Rat always felt to me like this weird. Everything you guys have always did is weird. It's always great, but it was this real left turn.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
And from the outside looking in, I always felt like, for me, that was like, it was like, I couldn't get more into Voivod than that album at that point,
cool.
Right?
Yeah.
And I felt like other fans were like,
no,
slipping away. Yeah. And I was like, what are you talking about? This is such a great record. And did you guys feel that well?
Yeah. I mean, everybody was waiting for Nothing Face Part 2. The label was, the fans were, and we totally went for something which had nothing to do with anything going on at that time. And we used Terry Brown to get this psychedelic side to things and all that. And it's of an alternative album. And it didn't go over well. It was a bit controversial, actually. Blackie split halfway through the mixing, and so it was very strange times. And of course, it didn't really go over well. And since it has been rediscovered. And now people tell me it's my favorite album now.
Yeah.
But in 91...
I'm standing in the crowd last night, and I'm like... Man, I hope they play Clouds in My House, right? They got to play Clouds in My House. I'm thinking it. And every time the crowd would go quiet, I'm like, I should shout it. Man, I got to tell this. I only got 70 minutes. I'm not going to shout it. And then the guy behind me goes, man, I wish I'd play something from Angel Rat. And I'm like,
Oh,
really? That's kind of cool. Yeah. Like, I'm not the only one, you know?
Well, next time we'll know. We actually, like, we were not too sure because we figured a set list in the afternoon. And we have a whole bunch of songs that we know. And so we thought, oh, maybe the festival is too heavy for the prowl, but it's such a rocking song that we shouldn't think that way. Yeah.
But it was interesting to me too, like, you know, when you have a career that's 30 years long, right? there was this really weird mix of people in the audience who, right up front, when you guys would play something off of Killing Technology or play, you know, Voivod, right? They're freaking out, right?
Yeah.
And then there's this other segment of the crowd when you play something off of Nothing Face, they're freaking out. But then the people who freaked out about the Planet Earth songs were the same ones who were freaking out about Killing Technology and the other stuff.
Yeah.
Really, really weird mix. And I think that that's just a side effect of having a career that where you guys have always tried new things as you go.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Of course, I mean, we really try not to repeat ourselves, but over the course of like 20 albums now, it's starting to be difficult. But it's true that some people like the thrash metal stuff and some people like the prog stuff. But I think that we have like figured a way to get the same energy out on every track that we play, every song. Try to get like a middle ground for everything. So one song is not too pop, and then the other song is not too trash. And we sort of like found a way to mix everything in a perfect blend where it's like equalized into it's a vibe that we try to get where everybody's going to enjoy the whole show. And it's always the same where we always win the crowd over after 3-4 songs, and at the end of the show, everybody loved it, and we're getting like tons of good comments outside today.
Well, you guys got a chant when even when the lights came on, people were still chanting Voivod.
Yeah. We had to stop at midnight, so because at midnight we turn into pumpkins. And
all right, so another thing that's always been interesting to me about you guys' career is that like when thrash was like riding huge. You guys weren't jumping on that bandwagon, and when you know like you said, like grunge started to happen and people starting to try Jane's Addiction type stuff, you guys went a total different way, and death metal was happening and you guys were not interested in that at all, and it's always felt to me like you guys were on the outside, and it's not just a geographic thing. I think that being one of the few bands from Canada, but just your outset, is that the same in your personal lives where like you always feel like on the outside of...
Yeah, definitely. Just my name away. I was born to be an outsider for sure, just with my art and stuff. And every time I have an exhibition, it's among outsider artists like Nick Blinko and, you know. And for Voivod, it's always been sort of a scenario where we are on a space station watching Earth, and because I did listen to all the bands from the Florida death metal scene, the black metal from Norway and all that, and I am aware of all that, and the new metal in the mid-90s, and I keep my eyes open and my ears, but we're always like evolving in a separate dimension, but once people get it, they can't get out of that dimension. Like I said, we see the same people year after year for like 31 years now.
Have you ever like sort of had that like feeling like it would be so great to just be part inside it sometimes?
Yeah, we had a lot of discussions on tour about that. About the fact that all of our contemporaries, friends, Testament, Metallica, Slayer, they all made it huge. And for us, it's always been very underground and cultish. And so we had a lot of discussions where we would ask ourselves, what are we doing wrong, you know? But it's, you can't really like let it bring you down. I know it. It means less of a financial security later, but hey, man, I mean, the fact that we had this long career and we're still touring, and it's kind of a privilege because On the other hand, many people I know in the business made it really big and disappeared right after. And for us, it's just, we feel privileged, really.
Last night, you know, you guys played only 70 minutes, which I've waited so long to see, hear those 70 minutes, right? And so I get in the car, I put on Chuck's show, because Chuck's on the air, so I got to listen to Chuck's show. But then this morning, like, get the kid in the car, I'm getting, making my way down to Housecore, I throw on Outer Limits, right? Because it's like, I got to hear more Voivod, you know? It's like, cool. You just wedded it. So what is next? What, are you guys going to tour again? Can you tour again? What's the plan?
The plan is we are writing new material, and then we have a long tour in January and February with Napalm Death, USA and Canada. We might even do that metal cruise again. We did it a few years ago.
70,000?
So, yeah.
Oh, we'll be there.
We were invited to do it, and we're waiting for the offer, the final offer. And all. So we're dealing with that right now. We really want a new album next year. We already started writing it, and it's really progressive. but we'll keep the trash side. Yeah, we're part of the trash metal scene, and I think it's the only time where we really fit into one big scene that was exploding. It's in the mid 80s when we toured with Celtic Frost, Possess, and all that, Creator, and we felt we were part of a big community, you know, and we released Roar with real trash metal, you know. But then as soon as we learned how to play a little better, respectively, Piggy was always good. He started when he was 9, but for us it was a kind of new, and so as soon as we really got a hold of our instruments, we started to include more complex material on Killing Tech than Dimension Atros and Nothing Face, and we rehearsed every night between 83 and 89. And by the time we did Nothing Face, it was just another dimension totally. And we were, it sounds like we were playing on a click track, but it wasn't. And we were really, really good at it, you know.
And what's interesting to me about those early albums is it's like there's a very, very distinct line, both in songwriting, in talent, and production. And so, you know, when you get to like Nothing Face and Angel Rat and Outer Limits, I imagine the budget for production is pretty much anything you want to do, right?
Yes, yes.
Now it's got to be a lot more challenging. Are you able to create the albums that you want to?
Yeah. We have to thank like Pro Tools and all the, you know, because it would have been impossible back then. Now the Universal MCA years were lots of budget and recording at Record Plant in LA and all that. And so these albums sound massive. And then we had to deal with more of a raw sound in the mid-90s with Negatron and Phobos, because we went back to indie. But nowadays, with new technology, We did the Target Earth for fairly cheap, and out in the woods, a great studio. And the guy from Oblivion, Pierre, he has a nice studio in the woods. And then we sent the tracks to Sanford Parker, which is here. He's playing tomorrow, actually. And he did an amazing job, at mixing the whole thing. But what we supplied him with was already like top notch because of all the digital technology that I'm playing on a real drum and all that, you know. But the fact that we can actually like enhance the whole thing with such great technology, it makes a whole lot. It makes the whole difference, because we don't have to spend like $200,000 in a studio, and you know, it's nowadays you can do amazing things with $25,000. You know, it's just insane.
Does that change like songwriting, or even what you like plan for what you're going to do on drums at all? Influence it at all?
not that much, but the easier part is the editing. And we used to do in the 80s a lot of tape manipulation, cutting the tapes and then flipping them backwards and gluing them back together, and it was just really stressful. but now it's just, you know, so easy, and that's really makes things easier for us to add the psychedelic part of things, you know, like in the band. Is yeah, the home studios now, it's just insane. It's great.
I heard an interview with Billy Joel a few months ago, and he was asked, like, what is it that in your career that you kind of regret? And he said, I regret writing songs where I have to sing so high because I can't sing like that anymore. And I'm watching you last night, and you look like absolutely... Like it's just second nature. You don't look tired. You're going from song to song to song. But do you ever like go, oh man, we should have written that song a little bit slower?
Well, I actually, some of the stuff I do play a little slower. Yeah. Especially when it's 9 minutes long, like Forgotten in Space. I learned to pace myself like I'm a marathon runner, you know, otherwise it'd be really difficult. But I know now, okay, if I go too crazy in that song, I'm fucked after that, you know. And so for especially Forgotten in Space, that's the one where I had to slow it down a little, and I have to pace myself on this one. But the rest is fine.
Are you when you tour? Are you dieting different than the way you used to, you know, back in the 90s, or doing different exercises or anything like that?
Since 98. I've been eating a lot better and taking care of myself a lot better, and I don't party because I thought, if I want to play thrash metal at 55 or 60, I really need to think it over. And so for the past 16 years, I've been really taking care of myself, and I think that's why I can play as fast as when I was 25 or so, you know. Yeah.
Going back in time a little bit, right? We hear horror stories about bands and their relationship with Noise Records. Did you guys have problems with Noise as well?
Not really. It's we switched labels many times, but it was like part of the evolution of becoming bigger and bigger, from Metal Blade to Noise to MCA. It's just that we got more and more attention and got better deals. And of course, it's always like disappointing for the label that helped you become something when you leave for a bigger label for more money. But we were lucky; we were always in good terms with the labels we were dealing with. And like Universal, when we took a turn back to our roots for Negatron, they said, "Well, we can't really promote that, but you're free to go and shop anywhere." Instead of shelving the contract or trying to sell it for $500,000, they just said, "You're free," because we were really like we were in good terms with them, so it's, you know, it's business, and that's the way.
Do you own any of the masters at this point?
No, not all of them, and it's a bit of a Kafka scenario right now for the MCA catalog. It's all available on iTunes, but the CDs are not out and the vinyls are not out. And they had like they have a Nothing Face, Angerat, and Other Limits. And when they bought Sanctuary, they ended up with Roar, Killing Technology, and Damage and Hatras. So we're trying to get like box sets out or anything, but they're just right now happy with releasing it on iTunes. And I mean, we do get the royalties, which is great, but I wish like there'd be some special vinyls or boxes. We're working on that.
Is there a time limit or anything like that that you know might expire and then it all comes to you, or is it just a matter of here's the money?
There are a lot of stories about like, oh, after 25 years you get your masters back and all that, but as much as I look at the contract, I don't see those clauses at all. And I mean, the first Slayer album and the first couple of Slayer albums, they're still on Metal Blade, and Warren Payne is still available on Metal Blade, and so it's all good, you know. We're eventually hoping to have, let's say, Century Media, or the label we're dealing with right now is Century Media. Or, well, eventually, it'd be great if they could do special releases of the old catalog on vinyls or even cassettes, you know. But it's a lot of work because when you are on the big labels, they have top priorities, and it's not. And I mean, we're way behind Mariah Carey on Universal, you know. Yeah.
All right. So it's real interesting you talking about going on the road with Napalm Death, because it seems like if there are two bands that just cut through the jungle harder than anybody else, it'd be you guys and Napalm. But Napalm seems like they had a whole army of bands come behind them, and I feel like there's really not anybody who's come behind Voivod.
No, once in a while, in the mid-90s, Fear Factory, you know.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. They totally ripped off the lyrical thing that you're going on Muffin Face.
And I heard some influence, and I got to meet the guys, and they like Voivod and all that, and even Meshuga and some of the stuff like that. And nowadays, what's that? There's one great band. They're brand new. Their name starts with a V also. It's not Virus, it's Vector.
Vector, okay.
Yeah, that's a band that they have a similar logo, and the music is very, very similar. And it's one of the bands that I really dig, that I can tell we're influenced by Voivod.
I mean, I imagine there's a part of you that goes, yes, but then there's another part of you that goes, hey, wait a minute, that's my car. You know, you know what I mean?
No. I'm always pleased to hear some. I mean, you know, it's just, to me, it's Piggy's legacy. Yeah, these weird chords and all that. So I'm always happy that he didn't create that for nothing. It's like people are learning a lot from it, you know?
Piggy. All right. So how long did you know before that he was ill before he passed away?
Not long. He told me early in 2005. There's something wrong, and then but he waited a little longer to check in March. And then he checked into the hospital and then spent the summer at the hospital. And then in the fall, in August, he was gone. So it was pretty sudden to us.
Had you spoken to him at all during that time from March through fall?
Oh, yeah. I spent the summer at the hospital with him, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, we had some pretty profound discussions. Yeah.
Was he hopeful or was he resigned?
I would say he was hopeful until he was so sick and so medicated that he didn't really realize what was going on. So there was not a point where he gave up hope or he was really like down and all that. He kept being like a happy kid I found at the hospital. And then eventually he slipped into a coma.
That's got to be just so hard to watch.
Yeah, because the physical aspect, I think, is the most traumatizing. The way people shrink and you know, and so it really opened my eyes to the fact that we are pretty fragile and we should take care of ourselves. And
there's so often, you know, I talk to people and, you know, we'll talk about one of my favorite topics. I love to talk about politics and religion, right? So when I talk about religion, it's like, but what do you think? What's next, right? Well, you got to at least think about it. And so many people I know are like, when I get there, I'll think about it. But until then, I'm not going to bother, right? Was he the type who was like, whatever? Or had he really given some thought as to what he thought was the future?
It's a very strange thing because while at the hospital he was reading a book about when all the water is going to be gone in 2050 and all that and so he was actually reading about the future, and it really impressed me, and we had discussions about the future, and so a very, very strange situation. And I guess he didn't really want to think about death at all, and it was still young too, 45, I think. Yeah,
absolutely. Mm. Did you did you, and then did you after? You know, I mean, how does that affect your perspective on all of it?
Oh, it really, like, I became a reclusive for 3 years until we reformed in 2008. But it took 3 years to get back on my feet. And then Snake phoned me and, okay, are you ready to get back? And I was, yeah. And then we found Blackie and Chewy, and that was it.
But that's interesting, because I would think, like, the moment he's gone, I'd be thinking, like, oh my goodness, any day could be my day. So I better do what I want to do right now, rather than, like, mourn, I guess. You know, does that make sense?
Well, for me, I thought, because of the accident, we had a bad accident in 98 in Germany, where we rolled and the singer was thrown out and all that. And
That's right. Yeah. The previous, I'm sorry.
Yeah, Eric Forrest, bassist singer, was really hurt bad and all that. And that stopped us for a year. And that's where I thought, okay, I'm going to start doing art for other people, because it made me realize that you can't really take it for granted, and it can stop any day. And then when it happened the second time in 2005, I was already connected to people where I was doing art for hip-hop artists and Dave Grohl and so Probot, you know. And yes. And so in 2005, when everything happened, I set up an art gallery online where people could contact me to do art, and so I just did that for 3 years, and I'm still doing that. I spend half my time doing art for other bands, or cover for books about metal, or tattoo, a lot of tattoo designs, and so I spend a lot of time. But for 3 years, I did only that, because I thought, well, a band is hard to manage, because there are four people, therefore four times more chances that something happens. So I thought, okay, I'm going to do my own thing and take care of myself. And, you know, but it's just that after a while, you really get antsy and want to play music again. And so that's why we found each other in 2008. And we had the morning was kind of gone and done, you know, so we were ready to get back on the road.
I would think that, like, with what happened to Piggy, and then when Blackie goes, yeah, I'm done again, I'm done. The first thing that would pop in my head is like, but don't you realize that this is finite, man? This might, you got to grab it and hold it,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, but, I mean, that's the way we think, you know, and, I mean, I don't know how long we can do that still, but I mean, we're going to give it a shot for another 10 years. You know, it's no trouble. I saw like Whitesnake a while back with Tommy Aldridge doing double bass drum for 90 minutes. And I thought, oh, I can do that when I'm 65 too. And so as long as, you know, I'm careful with what I put into my body, and I don't drink too much and all that, you know, I think it's going to be fine.
Yeah, maybe you ought to just, like, you know, do another very Angel Rat-like record, you know, just
yeah.
Slow it down, just hit it.
I actually thought about that eventually we might have to write something more mood-oriented.
Or just, like, you know, you just set up a machine, and, you know, and I got pads, I'm playing the pads, but, you know, yeah. The machine lives drives most of it, right? this has been so amazing to speak with you, and I feel like there's a world of other questions I would ask. But I guess, you know, much respect, because you guys are definitely one of the all-time greats, and it's been just an absolute honor to speak with you. Thank you.
Hey, thank you.
Absolutely.
I appreciate that. That was fun.
Anything else that you like, you know, got to get off your chest that, you know, that that you've always wanted to say?
Well, not really, except for thanks to the Iron Gang, and that's been supporting us for 31 years, and they can expect a new album next year. A lot of touring, because we decided to tour more starting 2015, and really concentrate on going across the world. And lately we've been concentrating on going to places we've never been before: Asia, South America, we're thinking of China and India, and so we're trying to reach new territories. And it's surprising how people know about Voivod everywhere on earth. It's kind of interesting.
Has So you've been able to make a career out of your art, whether it's your music or your art, the
yes.
entire way, correct?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So has that ever gotten in the way of just anything else that you wanted to do personally, you know? Is there anything that like has just never happened for you?
I was really lucky because I was able to combine graphics and music. So I have best of both worlds, and I'm really, really lucky.
The road doesn't like, you know, has never been like sort of like an outlet that because you're gone, you haven't been able to kind of focus on staying in one place?
Not really. I mean, you know, I did study science at university, and then Warren Pin came out. I decided to give it a shot, music business and all that. And so I had some... there were some times where I was thinking maybe I should go back and study science and might be more lucrative or whatever. But I love traveling so much. I always go back to Voivod because it makes us go around the planet and meet great people and play music, and it's really an addiction.
See, I told you he was cute.
Yeah. He is really cute.
No, not him. You were cute.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Fanboy. Yeah. I love that though. Hey man, when you're a fan of a band, I get it, you know.
I even had to ask him if he was like, I was trying, do you hear that? Like, is there a Mr. Voivod? You know, I was trying to find out if maybe there was like a scoop there, but no, it sounds like he's straight.
No, my favorite
he's French, but he's straight.
No, my favorite is the
French Canadians.
You know, criticizing people who ask these whatever inane interview questions, and then you're like, so you got anything else you want to say? What else do you want to talk about?
I didn't want it to end. Come on, everybody. I didn't want it to end.
It was
end.
So funny.
And I still had so many more. And I was
sitting there just internally just kind of laughing, yeah. And going, wow, this is cute. This is so cute. Well, congratulations.
It was
a very good interview. And he was, like I said, he was such a nice guy. And it was cool. All right. So one of the coolest things about Housecore is just the fact that you're standing around and you're standing next to each other. Like, we were watching Gwar on Saturday night, and there's Snake in a way, and all the guys from Voivod standing in front of us, right?
Yeah.
You know, I'm looking over there. I'm going, oh, hey, what's his name from Napalm Death? I'm like, oh, okay. They're like just hanging around and stuff. And, you know, it's one thing when... with like 70,000 tons, we talked about it on that podcast, where you're just walking around and you're like, oh, hey, Bobby Blitz is singing fucking karaoke in the middle of the night, you know, whatever. And you're trapped on this boat together, so you kind of expect that, right? I mean, you're going to run into these dudes because they're all there. It's the same situation at the Housecore Film Festival as well, because they're all just hanging out and they want to see the bands.
And the location where that is happening, there's nowhere to go.
Yeah, I mean, you're kind of tied to it. There's restaurants and stuff where you can go get stuff or whatever, but for the most part, you're in this complex together. And
there's a highway on one side, and then there's just the projects, and that's like there's nothing in between.
Well, I mean, because
it's changing though.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, that's how we got the dude from Decapitated. Was because we're standing there going, well, we missed that time window, and we go, wait a minute.
There he is
over there. Grab him. Yeah. Boom, and pull him in and grab him that way. And, you know, just seeing all kinds of people standing around. I was sitting out there in the smokers area, and and a friend of mine sitting next to me. He's like, so, or she's like, yeah, so who are all these people? I'm like, where? Like, in front of us? I was like, well, that's Voivod over there. I was like, over there's a drummer for Napalm Death. I was like, this guy's in this band. This guy's in that band. This guy over here's in King Parrot. This guy's in this band. This guy, and just going down the list, and they're all just hanging out with the average people of the festival, and it was really awesome.
Yeah, you know,
that's Bill Moseley. That's Chop Top right there. He's fucking hanging out.
But this is interesting because to me, it's like this genre is as important to music as like, you know, blues based rock and roll or anything else. Right? If you go to like the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame Awards, you're not going to be standing in the lobby with Bruce Springsteen over here and Eric Clapton over there and the Bee Gees, you know,
I mean, how many
crying in the corner.
Yeah.
It's just not going to happen.
I mean,
right.
How many stories did I hear about? I was standing in the crowd watching, watching Voivod or watching Portal with Phil Anselmo and Randy Blythe standing there.
It's We've met 500 people who had 2 hour conversation one on one each with Randy Blythe
in
48 hours.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And except for us.
Except for us.
It's okay, though. Like you said, I had a conversation with him.
Yeah, but you didn't. So, hey, can I record this?
No, because not hey, man, you know, we'll get there. We'll nail him down
here
later.
We're going to get there. Oh, my God. This is like one of the most interesting conversations that could possibly happen. And but, hey, you did line up a possibility for like a day-long like conversation.
Yeah, we're working on that.
I know. I'm not saying who, but that's pretty cool, dude.
Yeah, I'm working on that. I'm definitely working that angle. Somebody who just moved here to Austin. So, yeah it's some pretty cool stuff. And I'm ready to talk hot rods. So
Housecore is an amazing time.
Yeah,
it's
we had a great
really
time.
Really great time. The you know, it's hit or miss sometimes with some of the bands. I'll admit it, right? But with the between the movies and those crucial performances, it's just a show. It's a festival you got to go to.
Yeah, and I mean it's
unique.
It feels very fly by the seat of your pants. I mean, you're like going. Sometimes schedules are on, sometimes they're out. You know, there's some of that stuff that's a little frustrating here and there, and I get that, but overall it's like if you're just kind of laid back and having a good time, you will enjoy yourself.
Yeah.
And it's pretty awesome, man. So
I don't know how much the tickets are, but it's worth it.
Well, we'll worry about that next year because they'll probably go up. You know, get a couple successful ones under your belt, and that's what happens, right?
Get your early bird advance.
Yeah,
and you know, there's places to stay in town, Airbnbs and all that sort of thing.
We don't need to sell it. It's already
right.
Yeah, don't worry.
You know
about
what
it.
I'm saying. It's worth traveling for.
Yeah, actually, it kind of is.
Yeah. So.
And and what's weird is I was talking to Frank from Metal Injection about it, and he's like, I'm kind of stoked to find out what Austin is like without South by Southwest. Because a lot of people come in, especially industry people, come in for South by Southwest, and it's a whole different place.
Yeah.
I mean, this place is a fucking madhouse when South by Southwest is on. And, you know, this is a festival, but at the same time, the rest of the city is like, whatever. So you can go downtown, and it's not like a complete... It's not complete insanity. So it's really, it's a little bit different, man. So yeah, it's a lot of fun. It's something you got to experience.
Yeah.
And I'm glad and very happy we actually have to have it here, or we get to have it here in Austin. So
yeah.
That's why I still want to go to the barbecue. You know, I still want to go.
Yeah.
I still want to go to, like, there's so many of these other ones that I want to go to Maryland Death Fest.
We got to go to Knot Fest one of these times.
Yeah, I know. I know Knot Fest all weekend long.
Has anybody heard? Did they burn the camel ship?
I don't know. I haven't actually read. I don't think so. I thought they get the kibosh.
I know, but I was hoping that, like, they'd figure out a way around.
Do it anyway.
Yeah.
Instead, they just shot camel shit out from the stage that wasn't burning.
That actually would be a pretty cool idea. Just, sort of like a camel taco bun cannon.
Oh, that's not good. Hey, make sure you subscribe to us on iTunes. Just search Metal Sucks Podcast. You'll find us on iTunes and give us 5 stars. Tell us we suck. Make sure you follow us on the Twitter box. I am at Bearded Ape.
I am at Godless Speaks.
And we post this every week on Monday at MetalSucks.net.
SpeakPipe. Use the SpeakPipe.
Oh, yes. You can also leave us messages on SpeakPipe or troll us or whatever, because I feel that we may be getting some trolls.
And we've got something big for next week, too, so stay tuned.
We do?
Yeah.
Oh.
I'm super excited.
Okay. All right, then. I don't know what it is. I don't know what's going on, man. This is another edition of the Metal Sucks Podcast.